trying to understand Mexican democratization and the process of how it's happened, we could talk to Mexican presidents, Mexican politicians, but we need to find the voice of the Mexican people themselves. So we've come here to this retreat on Lake Champlain in Vermont to speak to someone who can tell us that.
Yeah, Bill, I think a lot of people just assume, as you implied, that it's public figures and political individuals that play the most significant role. In the Mexican case, in terms of the democratization process, what we call civil society has been just as significant, in fact, in many ways, more significant in that process early on, going all the way back, even in some cases, to the 1960s. And there's two aspects to this. One is to talk to an individual who was active in civil society, such as an intellectual, or in this particular case, an intellectual that was interested in survey research. The other aspect of it is to find out what were Mexicans in general thinking about these changes, and what was the direct impact of what we commonly call public opinion polls on people after those surveys were published, particularly in the case of Mexico in the electoral process itself, leading up to the 2000 presidential election, when an opposition candidate, Vicente Fox, representing the National Action Party, won the presidential race. This is why we invited Ambassador Miguel Basáñez to come up and visit me at our cottage on Lake Champlain in Vermont, who played a critical role in introducing and legitimizing the use of public opinion polling in Mexico very early in its evolution in Mexican usage, and someone that I have known for more than 30 years and actually worked with in carrying out some of these survey research projects in the past.
My name is Miguel Basáñez. I have been a professor at the Fletcher School since 2008, with a brief interruption as an ambassador to the US in 2015.
Many people know you in the United States and in Mexico as a pollster and as an important figure in the development of polling, but you've had a varied career that began when you left UNAM. Could you talk a little bit about the different phases of your career?
I normally said that I have lived three lives. The first 20 years as a Mexican government official from 68 to 88. I enjoyed those years very much. I, at some point, were in the president's office in 1980 to 82. I was in the State of Mexico government from 82 to 86, and then the Ministry of Energy, which was my last position. I was very much involved in the presidential pre-campaign in Mexico, and then I left, and I entered my second life as a pollster. I am guilty of having introduced public opinion polling in Mexico in 1988. I conducted the first poll for a presidential election in 1988, and that was commissioned by the newspaper La Jornada, and that was the beginning of polling in Mexico. And that lasted, I originally had thought of doing that for a couple of years, but that really turned into 20 years that I ended up in 2008 when I was asked by the Fletcher School to go and direct the Cultural Change Institute. And that's what moved me to Boston.
Can you tell us a little bit about who or what influenced you to become politically active? And was there any particular individual that was a mentor to you in public life? And how did they influence your attitudes and professional career?
I couldn't think of a specific person, maybe my dad. I was born in a very small town in Veracruz, in the north of Veracruz, Tuxpan. When I was born and lived there, it was 25,000 people, so it was really a small town. And my father was very, although he was a businessman, he was very much attracted to public life, and he was mayor of the town when I was in finishing primary school, and then he was local congressman, and my grandfather was a friend of the president, Ruiz Cortines, who used to go to Tuxpan to spend Christmas, and then I got to know Ruiz Cortines from a very early age. And then another very influential politician in Mexico was from Tuxpan, Jesús Reyes Heroles, and I also came to know him when I was very young. And the president used to go to Tuxpan, López Mateos. I got to know him when I was like 12 years old, 13 years old. So I think all those experiences kind of attracted me to public life. And although in high school I wanted to become a scientist, I love mathematics and physics and chemistry, but my dad just dreamed that I could become a lawyer. And then I went to the law school, which by that time in the National University, that was the place where presidents come out. So all my peers and my generation, we all wanted to become the president of the country. So you didn't even think of it. You just, I jump out of college and enter politics, and off I went. Immediately went to the campaign, and then as soon as the campaign finished, we got invited by another professor from the school into a position, and then a second, and that's how I began for 20 years.
You graduated as a part of one of the most important generations in Mexican history, the generation of 1968. Could you talk a little bit about that generation and then about your decision, like so many of them, to go abroad to get a graduate degree?
You're right in that I'm part of the 1968 generation, 68. Which, well, we call it 68 because that was the year of the student movement throughout the world, that it started in Paris in May 1968, and then spread all over the world. So in Mexico, the student movement of 68, I would say, following Enrique Krauss's fundamental generations, in Mexico you have four fundamental generations in the last two centuries. The 1810, which was the independence, then the 1864, which was the reform, Juarez and the liberals, then the 1910, which was the revolution, and then the 1968. The dream of our generation was democratizing Mexico. And if you contrast our fourth fundamental generation to the other three were successful generations. Mine was semi-successful because 68 moved the country into democratization, but it was not achieved then. So in a way, what we opened was a slow boiling movement that took much longer. It started in 68. Then you had an eruption of democratization in 88 when Cárdenas and the breaking of the PRI happened, and then the 88 movement, if we could call it like that, finally ended up in the 2000 transition. So that was my generation in UNAM. And of course I took part in the huge marches with the president of the university, Barrosierra, leading the March of the Silence, and many of those. So that's how I got involved. And then, of course, when I went to England, the culture shocks that I was living, simply, I was not aware of that at the beginning, but is the contrast of a vertical culture as the one that we have in Mexico, as opposed to horizontal culture as the one in England or the US. And the difference between those vertical and horizontal cultures starts so much that I began sensing that the benefits of horizontality, of democracy, were going to bring a lot of good to Mexico. I think because of my interest on mathematics and sciences and statistics, I got attracted to polling from my stay in England and the master's and the PhD. So when I got back to Mexico, I jumped into polling. But by those years, I was working in government. So for a good 10 years, I was doing, I began polling, but as a public official. Rob knows that because the first national poll that I did was about the nationalization of the banking system. And that was the first article that we wrote on the bank nationalization in Mexico. But then I began sensing that polling had the potential to bring social change because it was like a mirror. So when back in those days, it was the State Department, the Mexican Minister of Gobernación, who used to say, okay, the outcome of the election was 98% for PRI. Then nobody believed that, but when I began polling and say, this is what the public says, then people just said, yes, I believe the polls. I don't believe the official figures. And that's what brought that huge wave of social energy behind polling. And that's how I got involved into the democratization process.
You answered a question that I was going to ask you, this follow-up question that Bill asked you by talking about your work in the office of the presidency and doing survey research. So my sort of follow-up question to differentiate from the original question I was going to ask you is, were you the only person in government at that time that was actually doing survey research, like the poll you did for the nationalization of the bank, and then we wrote an article together and published it in Mexico. Was anybody else doing that sort of research?
In the 80s, there was a Gallup office in Mexico, but that Gallup office didn't want to go into politics, so they only did market research. And I cannot think, of course, there was the statistics office that used to do polls for health issues and economic, but polling was not used for political purposes at all. The World Value Survey that had been conducted in 1980 and had some political questions had been done by Gallup, but not even that produced a sustained current of polling. So when I began polling within government, I cannot think of any other colleague that was doing that.
Do you remember if the office of the presidency, when you were working in that research unit, any studies they asked you to do that people in the presidency wanted to use your methodology, if you will, your technique, to find out any information that would have policy
implications? No, because I actually was the coordinator of what should be the pollster of the president, but I recall suggesting, let's do public opinion polls. And even the president, what would say is, but the public knows very little, so why don't we ask the experts, which of course were the governors, the ministers, the higher officials that know better. And I said, well, but that's not public opinion. But nonetheless, so I was polling mainly because of my own interest on finding out what the public thought, but not that much because nobody kind of saw what's the benefit of learning the state of public opinion.
Your first important political poll happened during the 1988 election. Could you talk a little bit about that poll and the results you found regarding support for Cardenas and Salinas?
In 1988, I left the Ministry of Energy, March 88. And the minister, Del Mazo, left office and I left office with him the very same day. And I never ever returned to government until the ambassadorship. A few weeks after that, Reyes Heroles, Federico, we were very close friends, and then he said, he was the chief of the editorial board of La Jornada, and La Jornada had tried to organize kind of polling, but there was, and Federico knew that I was doing polls in government, so he said, why don't we organize a poll of the election? And so that's how it began, and the editor, Payan, told us, okay, why don't we do a pilot project in Mexico City? And so we ran a first poll on elections in Mexico City, I think that was March 88, and in that poll, it came out with Cardenas really, really high up. In that month, there were two left candidates, Cardenas and Eberto Castillo. And so when the poll came out, Eberto Castillo asked Payan, Cardenas was so high and Eberto Castillo was so low, then he asked Payan, is this a serious poll? And Payan said, I am not an expert, but it is Federico and Miguel. If you want, I can ask them to talk to you. So to make the long story short, we said, Ingeniero, you can have access to any data and analyze whatever you want. And so he did. And the outcome of that review was that he said, okay, I will decline in favor of Cardenas. Yeah. And then when I learned that, I said, gee, this is powerful. This is great. Because of course that led the left collapse into one candidate, which was Cardenas. And of course Cardenas was much higher in Mexico City than the PRI. We enjoyed that very much because Federico and I had many friends in pre. I had been in pre for, I still was in PRI in that year. So all our friends kept saying, no, come on, you are wrong. This is not like that. This is, and I said, okay, well, that's what the number says. So that was the March pilot, preparing the national survey that was, the election was, I think, July 6th, if I don't recall wrong. Those were the initial testings, I would say. And the poll was taking 3 weeks before the election. Can you imagine that? Now we try to take the poll the night before to be more accurate. But okay, so the poll was taken 3 weeks before the election. So it was June. second week of June or something like that. And when the poll came, it showed 43 for Salinas, 33 for Cárdenas, and 17 for Cloutier, plus about 10 of undecided. And then we had a group that we were analyzing the numbers. It was Carlos Monsiváis and Lorenzo Meyer and yours, Rod himself and Castañeda and Aguilar Sincer. We were about a group of 10 people. Word came out to Salinas that the numbers of the poll were very bad for them. So a few days later, Camacho invited me a coffee and said, "Oh, Carlos is so concerned that you're going to look very bad because we know that he's going to win with about 63. That's what Gallup poll said. So he wants to give you a chance to correct your numbers, you know." And I said, "Oh, please thank Carlos. Really, that it's very kind of him. But you know what? I'm going to stay with my numbers." And then those were the raw numbers. So I was making the prediction of how the election was going to end. And I published in La Jornada, it's a two pages publication showing why I thought Salinas was going to go up 7 points from 43 to 50, and that Cárdenas would remain 33 and Cloutier 17, and that. So that was published, and in the publication it shows the raw numbers, 43, 33, 17, and the prediction that was 50, 33, 17. And you may remember that the election took place on a Wednesday, and then about 2 o'clock in the morning, the system broke. And we couldn't believe it. Why the system broke? What's going on? And it took about a week until the outcome was released, exactly 50, 33, 17. And then, of course, that day, Payan called me and say, "What you did?" And I said, "Nothing. Why you say?" "Because the outcome of the election is exactly what we published." And I said, I don't know. And many years later, Camacho told me, "Well, that was the best adjustment that could be made, because Jornada had already said a number that was good
that
enough."
That is interesting.
Yes.
Very interesting.
So with many years of polling, what I came to believe is that I made a mistake, and that the 7 points were not in favor of Salinas, but most probably were in favor of Cárdenas. And that it's impossible to know who won, but what I could tell is that at least it was a tie, and the Mexican political system was not prepared to digest the tie. And so, okay, the establishment took the decision that Pierre I have won, and the system broke, and then the fire took care of the ballots and in Congress that happened a couple of years later. So that was it. But that really brought a lot of attention to polling and to the possibility of a strong competition, political competition. And that's when I began and I got involved in all of that. I enjoyed it.
So when you changed professions and got into survey research and public opinion polling as a career, you encountered a long-standing practice faced by journalists and Mexican intellectuals, government censorship. In a way, you got a soft version of it that you just described in answering this question that Bill asked you, and particularly censorship of any views that would be published which suggested criticism of the government itself. And you first encountered this somewhat in the 88 elections, and then very significantly during the Salinas administration itself. And I recall collaborating with you in the project that you did, trying to understand what public opinion was about the trade agreement between Mexico, the United States, and Canada, which eventually became the NAFTA agreement. Could you tell us a little, give us some examples and tell us a little bit more about those specific censorship experiences that you had during that period of time?
Oh, that was a very interesting part of the transition to democracy in Mexico. In addition to the national election of 88, we had the first gubernatorial election in Baja California, where we found that PAN, the right opposition party, was going to win. And that was one interesting one. The third was municipal elections in Michoacán, where we found that the left, the PRD, I think it was already PRD, the left opposition party was going to win. Then, of course, the criticisms was that to disregard what I was doing, sometimes they kept saying, oh no, Miguel is a priest, and oh no, he for sure moved now to PAN. No, now he moved to PRD. So, like if I was just rotating parties. And that's what led me to submit my resignation to the PRI, because there was not a point that I just kept in a party that I would not use at all, and showed kind of a conflict of interest with what I was doing on polling. And the strongest censorship, I would say, we faced was in the national election of 88, because we tried first to with La Jornada, but then La Jornada was pressed, they tried to stop that publication. And you actually, we try to go to other newspapers, and then they also said, polling? What is polling? And it's like Gallup in the U.S. Gallup? What is Gallup? The editors of national newspapers in Mexico have never heard of polling and have never heard of Gallup. Then we tried to make the big parties to buy into the election, and there was so the election poll, we paid it among a group of academics because we found, and then Jornada was pressed not to publish it, and it was rot when you said that a friend of yours from the New York Times would be willing to publish that, and that made that. Okay, that censorship was released, and finally
better to have it in La Jornada.
Better
than
to
New
have
York
it in
Times,
La Jornada right? than in the New York Times.
Yeah.
I think that was the strongest. But we kept on facing. That's what led us to the establishing of the journal Este País, because we were not being able to publish in any newspaper because there were many ways of censoring the publication. So we said, okay, let's set up a journal, and that's what we did with the establishing of Este País as a way to publish our polls. But of course, how can you think of a monthly magazine for polls that's supposed to be something that you should, but okay, that's what we could afford, and that's what we did. We made a national invitation to people, and then people put $100, $200, whatever, and that's how that began. Then, on important events as the NAFTA agreement, well, the NAFTA negotiations, or the opening up of relations to the church, those were two very important events that polling was able to take the photograph of that. And that was very interesting. particularly because on the, no, and there was a third, the bank's reprivatization. And in the bank's privatization, it was very interesting that in the nationalization of 1982, public opinion was completely in favor of the nationalization. And in the privatization, public opinion was also in favor. And I say, what's that? Yeah. And then I got to learn that it is the media effect. In 82, the media was sending a message that the nationalization was so good that public opinion was in favor. In 92, I think it was the privatization, it was that that was going to be so good that public opinion was in favor. So I began sensing that the media impact is very, very important on how you lead public opinion. Now, on the NAFTA thing, the negotiation of the free trade agreement happened something similar. The press and the TV and radio, all the media was saying that next morning after signing NAFTA, everybody was going to be happy and have access to all the good. So public opinion was so high in favor of NAFTA that that was similar to what I have observed. And something similar happened with the reestablishing of relations with the church. So that's how, and the other good thing is that Enrique Aldunsen and I, my business partner, we began teaching a course on public opinion polling at the time in Mexico. And then we began attracting students to polling. And because it was so highly debated, they were so enthusiastic about that, that was the way. The big names today are our students. They are the ones that keep on the polling business. So that's good.
Miguel, can you tell Bill and our audience a little bit about the censorship that took place when we tried to present the results of the pre-NAFTA poll at ETOM, and they pressured the rector, the president of the university, to not let us do it, even though the poll actually was favorable of public opinion, because it demonstrates the connection between the intellectual community and the use of polling.
I had forgotten about that, but I think that was when Ron Engelhardt went down to Mexico with Neil Nevitt, my colleague from Canada.
And we were going
make a presentation of the outcome, the findings of a poll that show that free trade was very favorable in the public Mexican public opinion, but because the government was so nervous about whatever I could say from polling, that they asked ITAM not to let it happen. And so it's good that you recall that. It was another example of the kind of ways in which it was the Secretaría de Gobernación, I think,
right,
in those days.
That's correct.
Yeah, pressing the university not to let a seminar happen because of they didn't know what we could tell.
And what I recall is that we used our contacts to try to put counter pressure on the government.
Yeah, that's right.
And they compromised. They said, all right, you can do the conference, but you can't advertise it in any of the newspapers in Mexico
City. Yeah, that's right.
So it was just word of mouth.
Sure. And of course, they were packed. All the kind of things that we were doing. Yes, you're right.
If we could go back to the magazine you founded, Este País, could you talk a little bit about the intellectual group who formed that magazine and what you hope to accomplish?
In 1988, I was invited to the first conference on the World Association for Public Opinion Research. And I didn't know that it existed. It was Nancy Belden. She's from DC. And she's a daughter of a Mexican. Then she invited me, and I was very pleasantly surprised on learning that there was a huge community of colleagues, professional public opinion pollsters. So I, WAPORT used to have, or the public opinion community used to have a magazine, Public Opinion, I think it was the name, that was full of figures and charts and tables, and I just fall in love with that. And then when we started facing all those problems in Mexico to publish our polls, I thought, gee, why don't we set up a public opinion magazine in Mexico? And then I told Federico, let's do that. And Jorge Castañeda and Aguilar Sincer and Santiago Krill, those were my close friends, that we were doing things together on those things. And then I began saying, if we have no access to newspapers, let's set this up. And we started spreading the word, and the empirical tradition in Mexico was not that very much in favor of polling. So the university, I recall that I first, when I left government, I tried to enter several universities, but I wanted them to help me with polling, and they kept on saying, polling? What is that about? What do you want that for? And I said, I want that to gather original data, so conduct research. I was not able to. So because of that neglect on the universities, I set up my own firm of public opinion polling. That's what I thought, well, I'll gather data for a couple of years, and then I concentrate on research from opinion data. And that's what I said, those couple of years turned 20. And that's when I moved to Fletcher, that was the first time that I was able to sit down really in depth and analyze my data. And that the outcome is the Three Cultures book that really take the whole span of data into analysis that I was not able before to do. On that context, we set up Este País. We had no money, so we made a public invitation. We sell shares. I think it was $100 a share or something like that. Right. And we raised like $200,000 or something like that. It was beautiful, and that's how Este País began, and it had a big impact in the empirical culture, because it began introducing polling. The first issue of Este País brings data from the World Value Survey about NAFTA. You are right on that, and the free trade agreement and the negotiation, that was in 1992. That was when the first issue came out, yeah.
In the early 1990s, you joined an influential organization of Mexicans from all walks of life to have discussions about how you might ensure a fair election in 1994 after Ernesto Zedillo was selected as the candidate of the PRI. Known as the San Angel Group, you were working behind the scenes to try and bring about an honest election. Could you provide us with some insights into your discussions and your perceptions and ultimately your goals to ensure a democratic transition in 1994?
I myself into writing about that. I want to review my first book and the second book and update it to include all those things. But let me share something. The 2000 attempts that we did has a background first in the 88 when the system broke, we said, how can that happen? Then in 94, we didn't that to happen. And in 94, we learned about exit polling. In 88, we knew nothing about exit polling. So the great innovation in 88 was simply polling. That was a big democratic innovation. But of course, the system counteracted that with the breaking of the computer system that night. So we say, how can we prevent that happening? And then we learn about exit polling, and we prepared in 94 exit polling that when we it was in a vapor meeting in Chicago in 92 that we Federico and I met with Mitofsky, who was the big name in exit polling in the US, and we had convinced him to come and help us in Mexico pro bono, because we had no money to pay him. And then when the government knew that, the government jumped on him and hired him and paid big money so that he was not with us. And they tried to stop us on exit polling. And we say, how are you going to stop us? We are not doing anything illegal. So then the way government reacted was, in order not having us say in the exit polls, they promoted many. So in 94, there were about 11 exit polls. That was very good business for the pollsters. That's how it all began. And that's what prepared the 2000 election. The reason I said this is that 94 was already so highly competed an election that Salinas was very concerned that the PRI could lose that election, that millions of dollars were spent to guarantee that the election was won by the PRI. And then we came to the idea of inviting a very broad sector of politicians, academic, businessmen, and that's how the Grupo San Angel came. The idea, as I was telling yesterday, the core of that was Jorge Castañeda, Aguilar Cinza, myself, Reyes Heroles, Demetrio Sodi, and that's how we began with the idea of the Grupo San Angel. And the first meeting, we were about 40 people, and then the next one, we were about 100, and then 200, and then, so that kept growing. But it was kind of a counter-elite movement, in a way. And that became so, so strong that it was showing that everything was prepared to. And so in a way, what began in 68 with the student movement and got energized in 88 with Cárdenas, it produced a slower moving transition that ended up in 2000. So of course, those days I was very, I wanted the transition to happen faster, but I think in a way was a good way of going. I was desperate to move it faster, but well, that's the way it moved.
One of the sentiments that public opinion polls show in Mexico regularly is the lack of support for political parties. Could you talk about that lack of support for political parties? And do you think this is something that needs to be revised or that it affects the democratization process?
Your question makes me think how I began transitioning from political polling in Mexico to cultural polling around the world. My work with Engelhardt was the coordinator of the World Value Survey. That is a survey conducted every 5 years in around 100 countries today, and is heavily on culture. So I began to been attracted to this worldview. And what you just mentioned about political parties in Mexico is not exclusive of Mexico. That's something that is all over the world, in the US as well as in Mexico. So what you have is that institutions in general, since the 1990s, began a tendency of declining preference in the public. And that is true of political parties. In the case of Mexico, differently to the US, in the US you have a high respect for the army and the courts and the educational system, whereas in Mexico, the army, the army has also good respect, but the police and the political parties and the politicians have a very low respect, the same as in the US, and the same all over the world. So, of course, in those, if I'm thinking back in 88, 94, 2000, that was kind of a surprise, because in Mexico we had no numbers, so you could think that public opinion was very respectful, and then suddenly we started finding that that was not true. And so that was the way, I should say that myself, as a political scientist, I was retrained on Mexico, because polling began showing me an image that was completely different than what I had learned from school. But I think that's the benefit of original research that public opinion polling data started showing.
We would argue that Mexico has achieved an electoral democracy in the last two decades. On the other hand, I think both Bill and I believe that Mexico has not successfully achieved what I would describe as a consolidated democracy that includes such characteristics as accountability, transparency, and the rule of law. So as you look back over the last three administrations since the election of Vicente Fox, why do you believe that Mexico has been unable to make more progress toward a consolidated democracy, and what can Mexico do to achieve a fuller democratic model?
I should say that the main problem is the rule of law. And that is very heavily connected to a topic that I've been attracted in the last few years, because I see in the transition to a rule of law a big potential today, as I saw in polling 25 years ago. Around the world, we have three legal systems: the Anglo-Saxon, the Islamic, and the Roman law. Each of those has a different attitude and relation to business. The Anglo-Saxon is very friendly to business, Islamic is very rigid and unfriendly to business, and the Roman law is in between. The Germanic side is more friendly, the French branch is modern friendly. And that connects to the rule of law. And so in the case of Mexico and all of Latin America, the rule of law is a big problem, because in a way, the legal system is something that helps the elites to keep the control that was left since the Spanish times. So in a way, builds up exclusionary institutions, as opposed to the Anglo-Saxon legal system that originally made inclusionary institutions, that brings all society on board of the benefits of the economic prosperity, as opposed to the systems where economic prosperity is for the 1%, and you find a way through the legal system to keep the 99% out of those benefits. So that's what I keep on saying, that the rule of law of inclusionary institutions have the potential of bringing huge changes. But that is really deeper, because that touches us, the structure of power and the distribution of the benefits of power. And that's where Mexico is right now at. So if you have no rule of law, then you have impunity. If you have impunity, you have corruption. And then you make a vicious circle that at some point needs to break. Democracy helps on that, but I would say my generation was a little bit naive that as soon as we got the alternancy with Fox, everything was going to be solved. And that's not true, because the political parties find a way to recapture the whole thing, and then you have a system in which the parties are, it's a learning process. Now it's a bit opening up again, but that's where rule of law becomes so important, and I'm committed into that.
After you came to the United States to teach at the Fletcher School, you had a conversation with the Chief Justice of the Mexican Supreme Court, and as a result of that conversation, you held a series of seminars for Mexican judges to consider the U.S. legal system. Could you talk about that particular meeting and how successful you think it was in altering the Mexican legal system?
When I moved for the first time to the U.S. in 95, I set up my polling firm in Princeton that was growing worldwide. And then I had a legal case with my headquarters in England. And then I began a suit that I had to make a decision if I started in England, in the US, or in Mexico. And I decided, okay, in the US. And just for my intellectual curiosity, I also started in Mexico. That legal suit in the U.S. in about 15 months had been ended in my favor, and in Mexico we had not been able to begin. Okay? So when I had that conversation with the Chief Supreme Court Justice, I mentioned that, and he said, oh, that's very interesting. How could we share that kind of things with the judges? Could you set up a seminar in Fletcher so that they could learn about these things? And that's how the seminar began. And I said, okay, let me suggest that. And then I went back to Fletcher and I said, why don't we do this? And to make a long story short, a few months later, 120 judges, 60 federal, 50 local, went up there. We divided the groups in groups of 30, because it was a lot to have them all at once. And then they went, in the morning we took them to the trials, a federal trial, a state trial, a local trial, and they were fascinated observing how all the dynamics. And then after lunch, we got back to school to discuss. What did you see? What did you like? What you did dislike? What can we take back to Mexico? What could be used? What we cannot use? And it was so interesting that they were immersed. It was a 70 hours full week of very, very intense. By the end of the week, they said, oh, gee, we didn't expect what we have seen. But you know what? It's beautiful. But this is not our culture. We cannot take it back. And I said, it's not our culture. Okay, let's go to Chile. And then I took the group to Chile, and we did exactly the same. And by the end of the week, they said, wow, then it is possible. It's easy. And I said, oh, it's easy. Let's go to Colombia. The reason we did that is that Chile is a successful story, but Colombia is a failed story. The reason of the success and the fail is that in Chile, it had been civil society, the one that took the transition from the inquisitorial system to the adversarial system. In Colombia, it had been the president who took the lead. But when the president changed, the new president said, this is not my project, so forget it. And so the transition got sunk in the middle of the river in Colombia. Whereas in Chile, when the president changed, the new president said the same, but the civil society said, no way, we want this to move on. And so after three presidents in Chile, the system had been going on, and then it was a success. In Colombia, it was not. So in Mexico, the transition from inquisitorial to adversarial began in 2008 with a constitutional modification. So by 2016, this year, last June, the whole process should be ready. So I was insisting in having the whole view in order to guarantee success. But that visit of the judges was absolutely life-changing for them. That they really were able to see the original model in the US, the great adaptation of the Chilean case, and the failed attempt of the Colombian. So to have the full story to Mexico.
Finally, how important do you believe social media and groups like the Soyo 132, a student movement during the 2012 presidential election, who use that type of media, are to the electoral process and democratic change? Have pollsters begun to evaluate their influence, and are such influences beginning to be incorporated in survey research?
This is a very important point. Polling around the world today is in a big problem, I should say, big trouble, because you have many changes, particularly in the US, you have a huge rejection of polling. So the rejection rate could go as high as 80, 90%. So how can you really tell what the general public thinks based on a sample of 10 or 15% of respondents? That's one problem. I would call that kind of the oversampling effect. People is in the US so tired of many requests for surveys that simply kept on. The second is a technological one. Landlines are almost gone. And the methodology for cellular phones is not there yet. But in the middle of that, then the industry is moving to internet surveys, because the face-to-face are absolutely, in economic terms, prohibitively in the US. So then that's what moved to telephone surveys. But now the telephones are gone. So the cellulars are not quite there yet. And then the internet came. So you have a technological problem, and that is making even exit polls problematic. So that I would say goes about the shaking numbers of the polling on elections. And then you have the social media. I would say the most impactful case is what we saw in the Arab Spring. That was a beautiful social movement organized almost overnight by social media that, of course, got excited young people around the world. But also, when you see what was the outcome afterwards, it helped to mobilize thousands of people. But then what happened next? In Mexico, we saw the Yo Soy 133 movement, which also produced a lot of enthusiasm, and it has started to introduce, in the case of Mexico, a little bit of accountability, because social media helps to mobilize the public. But it's, I should say, it's still, I think it's very promising, and that we need to take that into account. And I am in the same idea of how could we energize people. That's where we are now at.
Polling, it seems to me, has the possibility of having cultural bias embedded into the questions. Could you talk about the importance of culture, of language, and in background in the development of cultural polls?
Yes, culture has a lot of impact in the building of a questionnaire. In survey research, the key is asking good questions. If you do not ask a good question, you will not get a good answer, because garbage in, garbage out. And good questions are very sensitive to cultural context. But that's something that I came to learn with the cultural surveys that I've been working around the world, and the many effects that you have in many more aspects than just the questions itself. For instance, Asian countries, for instance, they tend not to go to the extremes in scales, but to the middle. Whereas Latin American countries tend to go to the extremes. And so that there are so many things that we could do a whole interview just on survey effects by cultures.
And even the meaning of an individual word. I remember in a project Miguel and I worked on where we were doing the same questionnaire in Chile, Costa Rica, and Mexico.
Sure.
And we, remind me if I have
Absolutely.
This right, the word libertad, liberty,
yeah.
We couldn't use it in Costa Rica because it was conceived differently than how you would use it in Mexico.
Yeah, that's right. So even words convey a very different meaning in different cultural contexts. So that was beautiful. And when you are analyzing data, it's very important that you are aware of those cultural differences if you want to produce a better analysis of what you are doing.